There is a disease, a wave of an attack that is coming to attack the whole world. There is a healing spirit that Jehovah is releasing in the body of Christ to stop this plague. The Spirit of God came upon me.
Fahamu wewe uliye Mungu wa kale na uliye Mungu wa leo, kazi zako zaonyesha uko wako wewe, umetukuka umeinuliwa ewe Bwana. Vizazi hadi vizazi ya kufahamu wewe, uliye Mungu wa kale na uliye Mungu wa leo, kazi zako zaonyesha uko wako wewe, umetukuka umeinuliwa ewe Bwana. Kama wewe Bwana, e Bwana, utukufu wote ni wako. na kuabudu wewe Bwana. Hakuna kama wewe Baba. Umejivika utukufu. Hey, umejivika heshima. Hakuna kama wewe Baba. Nina kuabudu leo. Tunakuabudu wewe. Uketi enzi ni pako. Wewe mfalme ya falme zote. Wewe ni Mungu. Hakuna mwingine kama wewe. Hey, Simba wa kabila la Yuda. Tunakuabudu, tunakuheshimu wewe. Wewe ni Mungu. Umeketi juu sana kwenye kiti cha enzi Baba. Umejivika utukufu Baba. La 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 babu. Wewe ni Mungu.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. We bless your name, Lord. We glorify you today. There is no one like you, Lord. We bless your name, Son of God. Thank you because of your love. Thank you because of your holy blood. Thank you because of your Holy Spirit. Thank you because of your presence. And thank you for your good hand upon our lives. As we share your word, give us understanding. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. I am Pastor Michael Wambua, Word Temple Church of God. We are here in the city of Nairobi, in our blessed nation of Kenya. We're in a blessed God easily. That is our Capernaum, where we were positioned by God to reach our generation with the revelation, with the power and the blessing of the Holy Spirit. I want us to continue sharing the word of God. For those who were following yesterday on Sunday, I began teaching on the glory in afflictions. Because the Bible promises that many are the afflictions for the righteous. There are many persecutions, troubles, hardships, challenges that come to us as human beings while we are on the face of the earth. And that is why the Bible teaches that it is not something that is strange. It is something that you are supposed to expect to happen. Good news is that God is so faithful, He will never allow you to be tempted beyond what you cannot handle. God is so faithful, He will never allow you to be tempted beyond your ability. So, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13, the Bible says, there has no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. Every temptation, trial, challenge, affliction, tribulation, anything that God will ever allow to come to you, to come to your family, to come to your ministry, man of God, woman of God, to come to your business, you businessman, whatever will ever come to you, it will never be strange, because God, first of all, measures your strength. He measures your capacity and your ability to handle what is going to happen in your life. In fact, you can measure the grace in your life, the blessing in your life, by what you go through. Now, the things that you wish were happening to others, it can be, if it happens to them, they are going to die. They are going to give up and they will never follow God again. But the Bible says there is no temptation that takes you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful. Praise the Lord. I want you to believe that God is faithful. He will never allow you to be tempted beyond your capacity to handle. So the Bible says, but God is faithful. What you are supposed to do in the time of afflictions, in the time of challenges, is to count on the faithfulness of God. I repeat again, you are supposed to count on the faithfulness of God. I want to repeat that portion again. You are supposed to count on the faithfulness of God. This is what Abraham did. In the book of Romans chapter 4, Romans chapter 4, the Bible says in Romans chapter 4 and verse 21, it says, and being fully persuaded, there was a divine persuasiveness in the heart of Abraham. He was aware that in his challenge, God was there. He says, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. So we count on the faithfulness of God in the time of our trials, in the time of our hardships, when it seems that there is no way out. You count on God because the Bible says He's a very faithful God. Reading from the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 11, I am made to know by the scriptures, by the help of the Holy Spirit, that all what you are supposed to do in the time of challenge, in the midst of your affliction, is to count on the faithfulness of God. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 11, it says, through faith, also Sarah herself, received strength to conceive seed. This time, the woman of God, Sarah, was 99 years of age. So, in the middle of her challenge, the Bible tells me she received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child. She delivered a child when she was past age. Why? The Bible says because she judged him. She judged God faithful who had promised. So listen, God is faithful. All what you are supposed to do now in the time of your affliction, when you don't know what to tell your wife, your husband, when you lack the language to express yourself to your children because of the troubles that are there, you can count on the faithfulness of God. And the Bible says, God is faithful, who will not allow you
we are back to our scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. It says, there has no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted above that you are able. So God knows the ability of your mind. He knows the ability of your soul. He knows the ability of your heart. So every time you see negative things happening to you, I want you to know that before they came to happen, Jehovah had already measured your ability, and they knew that you are able to handle what is happening. Good news is that the Bible says, but will with temptation also make a way to escape. The same God will make a way of escape. Why? That you may be able to bear it. Not that it will be taken away. Mark my words. Not that the challenge, the temptation is going to be taken away from you. No, he may not take the challenge away from you, but the anointing of God will come upon your life. The grace of God will be made sufficient for you. Your eyes will open in the midst of your challenge, and you begin to see the glory of God in your challenge. For example, we are in a time in our nation, just like other nations of the world. We are at crossroads when we come to decision making. And sometimes you can fear to take a stand in your decision because of the consequences that may follow after your decision. And that is why you are supposed to count on the faithfulness of God. You are supposed to count on the faithfulness of God. I am a believer, a man of God, pastoring a church now for 13 years. I know there are things that can come to your church, that is to your ministry, and sometimes you lack language of explanation because of the happening. It happened to us in Word Temple Church of God in the year 2018, in the month of May, where our ministry had been for 9 years. We were forced to leave that place because we were unable to raise 140 million in the short time that were given by the seller of the property where we were. The church moved, and for 7 months, in fact for 9 months, we were doing our services under tents during rains, during very hot weather. There are members of our church who had to leave us because of what was happening. But thank God, just like the way the Bible teaches, when men run away, they don't carry your God away with them. As we speak now, we got a place, we built the sanctuary, and the church of God is stronger now than the way it was before. So listen, there is nothing you can use to stop challenges from coming. What you are supposed to do is to learn how, in the midst of the challenge, you are supposed to see the hand of God moving in your life. Why? Because nothing just happens. When God allows something to happen, It happens for a reason. And God will always make a way of escape. And I'm saying this, it doesn't mean that God will take away the challenge from you or from your family or from the nation. But in the midst of the challenge, the Bible says, but God will with temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. That is where young believers, young Christians, they confuse it. Because when things happen that they never expected to happen, they think that they are cursed. You think that Satan is stronger than God. You begin to think that maybe you have sinned against God. And you run here and there looking for solutions. But listen, there is no need of going anywhere. Let us check from the Bible how Apostle Paul, blessed man of God, was able to handle the crisis of his life. How he was able to handle himself in the midst of affliction. The Bible says, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, the word of God says in verse, let me begin verse 3. This is one of the chapters you read, and then you are left with the questions. Was Apostle Paul an angel or a spirit without the body? Because the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, verse 2, he says, I knew a man in Christ about 14 years ago, whether in the body, I cannot tell, or whether out of the body, I cannot tell. God knows. Such an one caught up to the third heaven. You see, people think that the more spiritual you become, the more comfortable your life will be. Yes, your life will be very comfortable in your heart and in your mind. But listen, the higher you go into the things of God, the hotter it becomes. Somebody said that every new level you enter, there are new devils. Every new level you enter, you find new devils there. It may not be scripturally confirmed, but I believe that the higher you go into the things of God, the heavier the battles that you face. So this one used to be caught up to the third heaven, very spiritual. Verse 3 says, and I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knows how that he was caught up in paradise and had unspeakable words, which is not lawful for a man to utter. Now, I know somebody's thinking, if somebody can be full of God to that level, if somebody can be experiencing the supernatural naturally, like Apostle Paul, can he really face challenges? Can he be found in a furnace of affliction? The answer is yes. It doesn't matter how holy you are, how powerful you are. It doesn't matter how many hours you pray and how powerful you are in casting out devils. Challenges will come. And that is why I'm preparing you, because they are ahead of us. Hard times will still come. But how did he handle this? The word of God says in verse 5, he says, of such one will I glory, yet of myself I will not glory, but in my infirmities. Now this man of God is saying, and I believe Apostle Paul was referring to himself, he says he's not going to glory. He's going to take advantage of what was happening in his life to see the power of God. And I want to say to somebody listening to me, I know this teaching is not made for babes in Christ. I am speaking to mature men and women who will be able to help others, to help others who are challenged in their walk with God. And so, because of my time, and I want to come to the point, the Bible says in verse 7, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, and lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. Now, people talk so many things, theologians, great men, great women of God. But I don't want to go theoretically to confirm to you what the thorn of the flesh was, because it is written in the Bible. The Bible says, was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan. The messenger of Satan to buffet me. To buffet. What is to buffet? It is to beat. It is to torment. It is to oppose, to resist. So listen, there was such a struggle in the life of the Apostle Paul, the man who was able to go to heaven, the man who had things that were not lawful to be spoken on the face of the earth, yet he was facing challenges. There is something he did, and I want you to do it from today. Verse 8, 2 Corinthians 12, 8. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it may depart from me. The man of God resorted to prayer thrice every day. I want you to ask yourself, in the time of challenge, in the midst of your affliction, when you are in your midnight hour, what do you do? I know many people run away from churches. They think that the reason why things are not happening well or going well with them, it is because of the church you are in, or it is because of your pastor. It may be, but listen, there is nobody will ever run away from the trainings of God. Doesn't matter which country you will go. Doesn't matter. The most important thing, in the time of your affliction, make sure that your communion with the Holy Spirit is very strong. Make sure that you become extra sensitive to see and to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. I want to leave you with this. In the time of challenge, you can take time of prayer and fasting. Not to change the situation, no, but that you might be changed, transformed, positioned to a level where you can be right in your affliction and you see the power of God. So for that is thrice, this man sought God and the voice of God came. Hallelujah. All what you need there in the midst of your affliction is a whisper of the Holy Spirit in your heart. You can hear the voice of God in the midst of your furnace. When you are right there in the den of lions, when you are in the midst of the burning furnace of fire, allow your ears to be open, your eyes to be open. You will hear a voice. And the moment you hear that voice, while you are still in your affliction, you will see change. You'll be empowered, anointed, and graced to do great exploits in the kingdom. Verse 9. And they said to me, he sought God and God spoke. The Bible says, and he said to me, my grace is sufficient for thee. The problem was not taken away. The challenge was not taken away. The messenger of Satan was not taken away. But Jehovah himself spoke and they said, my grace is sufficient for thee. Then he says, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities. You will be happy in the middle of weaknesses, in the middle of challenge. He says, I will glory in my infirmities. Why? That the power of Christ may rest upon me. Let me ask you a question. Do you desire the power of Christ to rest upon your life? Do you want to see grace, double grace, manifesting through your life? Do you want to see anointing, very strong anointing, accompanying your life, your ministry, your business? The secret is not running away, but in the middle of your challenge, you call upon God. You will hear his voice. And the moment you hear his voice, that will be your turning point. I repeat, the moment you hear that voice, that will mark your turning point. I want to leave you with verse 10. 2 Corinthians 12:10. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities. Ask yourself, how can a human being like you say that he takes pleasure in afflictions? He takes pleasure in distress. He takes pleasure in the time of persecution. How do you take pleasure? That can only happen to somebody who sees glory in the midst of affliction. Somebody who sees grace, multiplication of grace. Somebody who sees greater anointing coming upon his life. That can only happen to a man who sees God where others cannot see him. So the man of God says, he says, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distress for Christ's sake. For Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. The moment that you think you are so weak, that is the time you are very, very, very strong. I want to talk to you, woman. There is a woman listening to me. You are at a verge of committing suicide. I want to warn you with the love of God. Don't do that. Allow the Spirit of God to come upon your life. And as I speak right now, the hand of God is upon you to break that yoke in the name of the Lord Jesus. Don't go and seek help from witch doctors. Don't dare. Don't sell your soul to the devil because of wealth or because of fame. There is somebody else listening to me. Your desire, that is, you want a quick answer and you think you can get it through forces of evil. You are not going to find your rest there. God is talking to somebody. You man of God listening to me. Don't care, don't torture yourself because of the church, because of the congregation that you have. Do this. Commit your life to God. Commit your ministry to God. And God is going to see you through. I want to pray. Blessed Father, in the name of Jesus, open our eyes to see our way of escape in this time of temptation, in the time of trial, in the time of persecution. Help us to see the way of escape that we may be able to bear what is happening in our lives. Release your grace. Release your power. Release your blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. For those who want to give their lives to Christ, because you need him, you need Jesus, pray this prayer after me. Lord Jesus Christ, I believe that I'm a sinner. I have no power to save myself, but I believe you died on the cross for me. You shed your blood for the remission of my sins. And I ask you now, Lord Jesus, forgive me all my sins. Wash me clean with your precious blood. Write my name in the book of life. And I confess with my mouth the belief of my heart that you, Jesus, you are the Christ, you are the Son of God, and by faith I receive you into my heart. And now I know I am born again, I am forgiven. Amen. For those who have prayed that prayer, the Lord Jesus has come into your heart. Your sins are forgiven. You are a child of God. Amen. And I believe we have this golden opportunity to honor God with our substances, to honor God with our offerings, with our gifts, to honor God with our tithes. We have our church till number there, 84-1690. You can use that and listen. Don't delay in obeying God. The moment you hear this instruction, just do something. It doesn't matter how much you have, that you can serve your God with. God is not after how much you are going to give. God is after your faithfulness. Whatever amount that Jehovah will lay in your heart, do that. Let me pray for you, blessed Father. Thank you for this, my brother, my sister. Jehovah was purposed in his heart to serve you. I pray that your blessing will never depart from their lives, will never depart from their houses. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I want to announce that tomorrow, on Tuesday, 9 in the morning, I will have Pastors Fellowship coming live on Facebook. So I want you to call a man of God somewhere, a pastor. I want to share, because we usually have pastors trainings every Tuesday, and I want you to be part of it tomorrow. Get ready with your Bible, with your book. Get enough bundles of whichever way you are empowering your gadget with. And let us hear what the Lord is saying. Be blessed. In Jesus' name, I will call our music minister to bless our hearts as we worship the Lord. Hallelujah.
Usiye shindwa, wewe ni Mungu. Usiye shindwa, usiye shindwa, usiye shindwa, wewe ni Mungu. Usiye shindwa, usiye lemewa, usiye lemewa, wewe ni Mungu. Usiye shindwa, usiye saidiwa, usiye saidiwa, wewe ni Mungu. Usiye shindwa, usiye lala, usiye lala, wewe ni Mungu. Usiye shindwa, usiye sinzia, wewe Mungu wa milele. Tena mwisho, usiye shindwa, usiye shindwa, unaponya kila aina magonjwa, wewe ni Mungu. Usiye shindwa, wewe ni Baba, wewe ni Bwana. Wewe ni Mungu, usiye shindwa, usiye shindwa, usiye shindwa Baba. Wewe ni Mungu, usiye shindwa, usiye shindwa, usiye shindwa, wewe ni Mungu, usiye shindwa, wewe ni Mungu, usiye shindwa.